Okay, I've started the recording and I'm going to go ahead and pass it off to Peggy Kell from the League of Women Voters to introduce the candidates. Peggy, take it away.
Thank you, Brian. Good evening. My name is Peggy Kell. I'm the Voter Service Chair for the Oak Park River Forest League of Women Voters. Tonight, we're holding a candidate forum for the contested River Forest School Board District 90 municipal election. A recording of this evening will be posted on our website at lwvoprf.org and on the library's website for later viewing by voters. The League does not endorse candidates, but does believe that voters should hear from those that are running to represent them. Our League will be having candidate forums for the contested races in Oak Park, River Forest, and Forest Park in the next few weeks. Please visit our website calendar, again, at lwvoprf.org for the dates and the links to register, as all of our forums will be virtual. You can email questions for candidates in advance of these forums by emailing lwv1924@gmail.com. You will also be able to submit questions during the forums. The River Forest Library is our valued partner in this forum. Thanks to Shannon Gruber and Brian Wallowitz for all their help and technology for this event. Candidates will start with opening statements of 1 minute, followed by questions for all, and finishing with 1 minute closing statements. We will start in alphabetical order and then rotate through the candidates. Candidates are Joseph Cortese, Cal Davis, Eric Eisenberg, and Christine Mackey. We'll begin with an opening statement. Joe, you will begin, please.
Thanks, good evening. I'd like to thank the League of Women Voters for having me, and thanks everyone for joining tonight's forum. I'm Joe Cortese, and my wife and I moved to River Forest about 9 years ago. My wife actually grew up in River Forest and attended Willard, Roosevelt, and OPRF High School. We have three daughters who are all currently attending Willard Elementary School. And I'm running for the District 90 School Board because I firmly believe a high quality education is one of the most important services a community provides its children. I believe it's especially important for our district because many of our students are just beginning their academic journeys, and the quality of the education that we're providing them will impact the rest of their lives. Currently, I'm a partner with Fiducian Advisors, an independent investment consulting firm. And through my work, I have nearly 20 years experience working with public, private, national, and local nonprofit foundation and endowment boards. And I'll rely on this experience as a member of the District 90 School Board to ensure every student has access to the resources and support necessary to achieve their academic and personal best.
Thank you. Cal? Make sure you unmute yourself.
Good evening, I'm Cal Davis. First of all, I'd like to thank the League of Women Voters for their constant efforts on creating forums. I've been in River Forest 25 years. I have two children, a sixth grader at Roosevelt and a 12th grader at OPRF. I can honestly say from experience that we have an effective school system that produces students who are ready to compete in post-secondary arenas. It is the school board's intention to examine our curricular resources and explore new options if needed, social emotional learning, budgeting, the teacher's contract, and an audit of the 100-year-old buildings to determine the school's capital development needs. I've been in the construction business now for 5 to 6 years. Before that, I was in the financial business for 20 years. Currently, I'm involved in for the Terminal 5. Oops. And that's it. I think I'm having a problem here.
Yeah, the audio is reverberating. Okay, thanks, Cal. Eric?
Yes, and thanks, Peggy, and thanks to the League of Women Voters for hosting this forum. I'm running for the D90 School Board because I believe that my personal and professional experience prepares me well to serve to translate the values of the River Forest community into action on the D90 School Board. Like many families, my wife Emily and I moved to River Forest for the schools, and our three daughters attend either Lincoln or Roosevelt. For me, it was a homecoming. I grew up in River Forest, attended Willard, Roosevelt, and OPRF. And after college, one of my first jobs was to work for the Illinois Association of School Boards. In this capacity, I traveled around the state to districts working with superintendents and committees of school board members to update their school board policy manuals. In that way, by working through all 8 sections of the manual, I learned about every aspect of what a school board does and gained experience working directly with superintendents and board members. Later, I earned a PhD in economics, and that launched my career as a quantitative researcher, studying what programs, policy, and strategies work well for students and which do not. I'm currently working on studies of English learners, teachers, and students with disabilities. So in sum, I think that my experience suits me well to work on behalf of students in River Forest and the community.
Thank you. Christine?
Yes. Hi, everyone. Thanks so much for spending precious time with us tonight. Thanks to the League of Women Voters. And thank you to the current River Forest Board of Education and all your predecessors for your exemplary service. I am very grateful to all of you because you have produced great schools in this district for many, many years. So thank you. I offer myself to the task because I believe in the urgency of the task going forward. I think that the health of our schools, that upon the health of our schools rests the intrinsic value of this community. I think the schools are the cornerstone, and that's a part of how I got into this race. I offer you many years of experience as a parent, an educator, and a businesswoman. I retired from economic consulting 5 years ago, and since then have been working for the Midwest Jesuits. We oversee 23 schools and 6 universities across the 12-state region. So I'm deep into the thoughts and the ideas surrounding education, and I think I have something to bring to the table in that respect. I also want to say thank you very much for having us in your living rooms tonight, and I look forward to working together with everyone, families, teachers, parents, and of course, the current school board members. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, our first question, Cal, you're going to start off with the first question. And again, remember, if you ever need me to repeat the question, just ask. PING is a 25-year-old community nonprofit organization providing band and orchestra instruments, mentoring, workshops, and access to lessons, music camps, and trips for students in grades 4 through 12. They do this for District 90, 97, and 200. Currently, the school districts provide no monetary support to PING. Would you support District 90 funding to provide and maintain instruments for low-income students? At the very minimum, in partnership with PING. Also, would you consider broader funding of PING to fund instruments and music enrichment program?
Okay, programs, most definitely. I actually was at the musical at Roosevelt over the weekend, and I met someone from PING. And I think a big issue, and I brought this up to her, a big issue with PING is children get an instrument, fifth grade, sixth grade. They play it for a year, they play it for 2 years, and then they stop. I've been in many garages in River Forest and seen a trumpet, a tuba, or violins just sitting there. I think we need to open it up, and we need to get these instruments donated back to PING or to PING, because they probably paid for them through the school. And I think that would help a lot with the acquisition of instruments for children. And then at the same time, the school board could work with PING and create programs, because I've been to a lot of recitals this year. My daughter plays the violin and sometimes the viola. And those are the type of programs that the school needs that helps us to prosper. They are parental programs where parents are able to come and see the progress of their children from when they play the violin in fifth grade and then go to eighth grade, and they just see it progressing.
Thank you. Eric?
Thanks, Peggy. Can you just repeat the question for me, please?
Absolutely. PING is a 25-year-old, do you need all that? PING is a 25-year-old community nonprofit organization providing band and orchestra instruments, mentoring workshops, and access to lessons, music camps, and trips for students in need in grades 4 through 12. They do this for D90, 97, and 200. Currently, the school districts provide no monetary support to PING. Would you support D90 funding to provide and maintain instruments to low-income students at the very minimum in partnership with PING? Also, would you consider broader funding of PING to fund instruments and musical enrichment programming?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. I know that D90 has a really outstanding music program. My two older daughters participate. One is a cellist, one is a violinist. As I've talked to members of the community, they said great things also about the band program, really appreciative of the instructors and of the music program. The question here is, what kind of impact would we have on changing the behavior of students? Would we bring more students into music lessons, particularly low-income students, into receiving music lessons? And would that be a cost-effective way of doing it? I think that we'd really want to learn more about what kind of kids are entering into taking up an instrument, and also what kind of students are see as a barrier and see the cost of renting instruments as a barrier to getting in. With that kind of information, we would be able to better understand, is this a program that we're just missing out on funding and missing out on the opportunity for a lot of kids to pick up instruments? And would it be proper then for the district to consider kicking in some of its own funds in addition to the donations that go towards funding the band and orchestra now?
Thank you. Christine?
So I love the idea of music programs in schools, and I'm very impressed with what I've seen thus far already happening in the schools. You know, the Park District has outsourced some of its programming to wonderful groups. There's a soccer group that they partner with, and I think the school could do the same with a group like PING. But I'd have to know a little bit more about the group, and I'd have to know, like Eric, a little bit more about what is the unmet need.
Thank you. Joe?
Sure, yeah. So to me, it's an issue of access and ensuring that every student in D90 has the ability to access the music program that wants to access the program. And I think it's an opportunity for us to take a look at the situation. The finances of it, I think, are a separate issue, and we'll probably get more into finances in the school district later. But there are trade-offs when you're talking additional support for one program versus another. Perhaps there are creative solutions to the issue. Maybe there are other outside organizations that would be willing to help support underprivileged children having access to music education and those sorts of things. So I think we can certainly take a look at it. We can certainly see what the options are to ensure, again, that every child has access to the music program that wants to have access to it. And I'm sure as a community, we can come together to find a resolution.
Thank you. Eric, you're going to have the next question to start. What does equity in education mean to you, and how would you work toward belongingness and inclusion in District 90?
See, thanks, Peggy, for asking that question about equity. For me, equity is about a mindset that for a Board of Education member that they bring to establishing programs and policies. And the mindset is, when establishing a policy, you must not only think about how will this affect students altogether, but also think about how will it affect the students who are most struggling? How is it going to affect the most disadvantaged students? As an education researcher who spent my career evaluating programs, policies, and strategies on behalf mainly of disadvantaged students, I think equity is a very important consideration. The other part of equity is, when we go back to evaluate programs, and I think the board owes it to the students and to the community to, whenever it makes a major change in policy, to evaluate and look at what it's doing and see, is that program playing out in the way that's expected and bringing the kind of benefits that were intended? Or do we need a course correction and think about maybe other ways of altering the policy? And the equity mindset says we need to not only do this for all students, but also consider, how is that policy playing out, again, for the most disadvantaged and most struggling kids who might be most negatively impacted potentially by the policy change?
Thank you. Christine?
So when I think about the idea of equity in schools, I think about great teachers, because I think before we ever started to talk about this as an issue to address in schools, before that, great teachers everywhere were doing that every day in the classroom, making sure that every kid felt like they belonged, making sure that every bit of opportunity was accessible by every student. So I think that's been going on in great classrooms across the country forever. I've heard a lot about this as relates to our own district, and not knowing as much about the nuances, I guess I would say that I want every child, no matter their story, to feel like school is a place for them and that they can learn and grow and develop at their best rate, the same as everyone.
Thank you. Joe?
To me, equity means equal opportunity for all students and equal access to the resources that every student needs in order to achieve their best. Through my firm, I've attended a number of diversity, equity, and inclusion seminars, which have helped me better understand my implicit biases, how to be anti-racist, how to be more supportive of others generally. And I know we have those programs available to our administrators and teachers. And I think we're doing a good job there. We can always continue to work harder there, but I know we've undertaken a number of initiatives on behalf of the school district. The other thing I would say is that we have a relatively small number of students overall, less than 1500 students total in our district. I think we have the opportunity to pinpoint every student that needs additional resource, additional accommodation, has some specific circumstance that they need help with. And I think we can work together to ensure that those students have access to the resources that they need.
Thank you. Cal?
Equity. Equity is everyone's treated the same. Everyone has the same resources, but it's not just the student. It's us as a school board. It's us as a community. It's teachers, it's administrators, as well as students. It's very important because once they get the resources and once they're treated equally by the community as a whole in every program, whether it's math, band, cross country, or at the library, that's when everyone can move on to the next level, high school, college, and be successful people in society. So equity encompasses a big scope. It's not just the school board passing a rule. It's not just, teachers, one teacher acts this way, one teacher acts that way, or just students, whether they're respectful to everyone. It's the whole scope of everyone being involved and moving forward with this.
Thank you. Christine, you're going to have the next question first. This question will be about block scheduling at Roosevelt. Some parents have asked for a town hall on block scheduling from the board and the administration. Would you be willing to engage your constituents in a town hall on block scheduling if elected?
Absolutely. I think that every time we can engage the citizenry and people feel like they have a voice, we're all as a community better off. So yes, I would definitely entertain that idea, and I would support any group of parents that wants to have a rich discussion about what's happening in the schools.
Thank you. Joe?
Absolutely. I'd be more than happy to entertain an interaction with the community regarding block scheduling. It's interesting in the conversations that I've had sort of prior to deciding to run for the school board and since the decision, I've heard different things. I've heard some teachers and administrators say that block scheduling is a positive because it means that we're not as rushed in teaching complex curriculum that could take more time. I've heard from some parents that it's hard for children to maintain focus for that period of time. And frankly, as a father of three young girls, I kind of understand where they're coming from with that. So I think the key is exactly that, to get the community involved, to be transparent in how we're looking at this and measuring it, and to determine if it's the right thing for the students. And if not, how are we going to change it and make it better?
Thank you. Cal?
Block scheduling. Town hall, we've had various town halls. Since the pandemic, everything's kind of quieted down a bit, but we have had town hall meetings before, not just for District 90, but between District 90, 97, and 200, we've had town hall meetings. Block scheduling came up because we needed more minutes for math. So this was one of the solutions for the math issue that had come up some years ago. Do I support block scheduling? Yes. Would I be open to a town hall? I'm always open to meeting anyone. People see me in Jewel all the time. They pull me aside and talk to me. I just want to state one fact. If you look on the state report card, anyone can go to the, just Google D90 state report card. Over 90% of eighth graders pass algebra. That is one of the few statistics that actually come from the school and go to the state. And if you look at any other schools in the area or throughout the state, that's one of the highest percentages. And that's from block scheduling and the longer math period.
Thank you. Eric?
Yes, I would absolutely be happy to meet with parents talking about block scheduling. I think block scheduling, like I was saying about evaluating policies with equity in mind a minute ago, is one of those things that when a school board passes a major policy change, you want to then take a look and see, is it working as intended? Are there unintended consequences of making this change? And what can we do to improve things? Like Joe, if I've talked to people who have brought this question to my attention, some people very much like block scheduling, some people very much been disappointed with the change. But I think getting this out in the open and talking about it, I think it's absolutely the right thing to do. I mean, if you think about it, it's not a slam dunk that block scheduling is going to work for kids 10 to 14 years old. You're talking about 82-minute class periods. This used to be a length of time reserved for college students, meaning a couple of times a week. So I think it's very much a kind of question that we would want to have a town hall about and try to find a way forward, whether that's continuing with the current block schedule. Doesn't necessarily mean going back to the old eight period system. It could mean something in between, but we have to know what's working about block scheduling, what's not working, to find the right mix going forward.
Thank you. Joe, you're going to start off the next question. Share your thoughts on the effectiveness of D90's current reading and writing programs and if it comports with the science of reading. In your opinion, might there be an opportunity to make and shift to better support our young readers?
So I know the reading curriculum is an important topic, and a lot of people have approached me to discuss this. A number of folks do feel that it's not necessarily meeting the needs of our students and that it should be reviewed. I would say the good news is, in my conversations leading up to tonight with administrators, we review every part of the curriculum on a regular basis. And as I understand it, I believe the reading curriculum is up for review perhaps next year or the following year. And I think this will be a really important review. I think we need to be very thorough in how we take a look at this and the impacts that it's had on the district. And I've also heard from district members that, you know, in addition to just the reading curriculum itself, there are other supporting resources that are provided if the core curriculum isn't necessarily working for a particular student. So I think there's a very important question here that needs to be answered and researched. And we as a district have the opportunity to review the reading curriculum, ensure that it's working as intended. And if not, we need to revise it.
Thank you. Cal?
The reading curriculum is always under review. Reading is not it's not a perfect science. Not all kids are going to be able to read at six or at seven. We have three different phases where kids that can go through the phonics and word recognition and things like that, they go through and they're fine. Second and third tier kids may need help, and we will give them that help because it's an equitable thing to do. I think the problem is there are a lot of reading curriculums out there, and they are on the internet, and people talk about them, but they're not proven. They have no facts behind them of how many kids we've taught to read, 10 million, 10 billion or whatever. They have just stated that they're reading curriculum. We have people trained, our administrators, that go through curriculums every year. Our teachers do professional development on reading curriculums, and we teach kids how to read. Our first through third graders have not had any issues this year, no issues from parents or anything.
Thank you, Cal. Eric?
I think the reading curriculum is something that we definitely want to take a look at in District 90. There are a lot of subjects on which you'd like to say, I would like to use an evidence-based approach, but there isn't the evidence out there. Reading is not one of those subjects. It's been very well studied in the research literature, and people have come to a consensus on what works for the majority of kids, including phonics instruction. So if we take an approach that isn't following that, I think we are definitely needing to take a look at how it's working. Now, I can give you an example of a district that has done this. So over my career, I've worked on a lot of projects, a lot of evaluations. I worked on one a few years ago with the Oakland Unified School District in California. And they had found that the approach called level literacy intervention, which is the Fondas and Pinnell approach, having some research backing that it worked well as a supplementary curriculum in elementary school, was something they would apply to their middle school students. Because they unfortunately had a lot of middle school students who were four or more years behind in reading. The idea being that if this works for elementary school students, it might work for middle schoolers that are falling behind at the elementary level. We did the evaluation, we found a difference, but we found that business as usual was working better than the Fondas and Pinnell curriculum. If Oakland can learn from its experience and improve, so can River Forest.
Thank you. Christine?
So I believe that the reading curriculum is a hot button issue amongst the electorate. And I think it's something that can't wait for some planned review a couple of years down the road. I think it's something that really deserves to be heard and to be studied and to be reviewed. You know, if our students were performing all at grade level or above, then I think that by itself is evidence that the curriculum is fine as is. But I do think it needs a review, and I'm very willing to undertake that task.
Thank you. Cal, you're going to start with this next question. Firearms are the leading cause of death for children and teens between the ages of 1 and 19 in the United States. As a member of the school board, what specific actions will you take to prioritize gun safety throughout the school community?
Well, yearly at the III conference, we always send a representative. There's a big thing going on. And 80 is the border in Illinois. So if you're south of 80, you're considered a Southerner. If you're north of 80, you're considered a Chicagoan. People in Southern Illinois are voting for guns in school. They're voting for a designated gun-registered concealed carry person to have the gun in school. And that's because there's a big distance from the police station to the actual schools. We are within minutes, sometimes less than a minute, from the police station to our schools. So we don't have the need so much for that particular issue of having a gun holder in the school. We have to educate. We have to make sure that parents realize that they need to have locks on their guns and have them stored if they do have them in the house. I know River Forest gives out free gun locks. And we just need to, you know, be cognizant that children are able to get two firearms, and we just have to keep them away from them.
Thank you. Eric?
Peggy, would you repeat the question, please? Sure.
Firearms are the leading cause of death for children and teens between the ages of 1 and 19 in the United States. As a member of the school board, what specific actions will you take to prioritize gun safety throughout the school community?
Well, I think that guns have no place at school. I think that there's no reason to be considering having armed personnel in our elementary school, no reason to have the guns in the school. And so we need to keep guns out of school. And that's the leading way that we can contribute to gun safety in D90.
Thank you. Christine?
So I think firearms is a really important thing for us to agree on as a community. I myself would suggest that we, like Eric, that we don't have guns in schools. And because Cal's reason that we have police nearby, I think is a very compelling argument. The thing that I would say that we might have a little bit more responsibility for is teaching kids about gun safety, not so much because of what's happening in the schools, but what's happening out in the world. And I think that unless you have a parent who's a responsible registered gun owner, you would have no access to that information. So I think maybe we could take on a little bit more responsibility to educate students about gun safety.
Thank you. Joe?
Yeah, I basically agree with everything that's been said up to this point on the issue. First of all, there are state and local laws and ordinances regarding firearms and where they are allowed and where they are not allowed. So of course, we need to continue to adhere to those laws and ordinances. But I do think there is an opportunity to educate everyone, gun owners, non-gun owners, parents, children, faculty, staff. I do think we need to be a little bit careful about, you know, equating the fact that it is a leading cause of death among children to the sort of the school environment. Those things are not related. But I do think there is an opportunity for more education so that everyone understands the situation better and it is resolved in that way.
Thank you. Eric, you're going to start this next question. Discuss your views on the current state of D90's finances and any changes you would make to improve the financial health of our district during your term.
Yeah, thanks for a great question, Peggy. So D90 has been dependent for some time on bond funding as a way to cover even some of the more general expenses, not even getting into the capital expenses that are usually the reason why districts use bond funding. And we've been able to do that rather, you know, relatively successfully over the past several years because of the low interest rates means that's been a relatively inexpensive way to fund the schools. But as anybody know who follows the news or goes to the stores, we now have a period of inflation and of higher interest rates. So as these bonds come due, we need to be thinking about, are there going to be other strategies to fund the schools going forward? Because we're going to be facing a lot more higher interest rate environment next time we would need to be considering reissuing the bonds.
Thank you. Christine?
So regarding financing in our district, we have a robust budget. We're spending about $24,000 a student per year, and that puts us above the average in Illinois of $19,000 a student per year. So I think we have money to work with. That said, we have felt the need in the past to do bond issuances. And I'm not at all against that, but I want to make sure that when we go out for a bond issue, we're really considering other avenues to reduce expenses. I also want to make sure that if we're going to go out for a bond issuance, we have support of the community. And I think that there are other roads to finance the district, and that is levy a greater tax on the residents. People are very much against that. I've listened to many constituents who just cringe about the idea. So again, all that requires community discussion. And I would like this to all be transparent.
Thank you. Joe?
Overall, I would characterize D90's financial position as relatively pretty good, but I'm not sure if everybody on the call tonight knows that the district has been in a deficit spending mode for the last couple of years. Simply means that the district is spending more money than it's bringing in, which means we are spending down assets over time. In my discussions with Anthony Cozy and the administration, we have adequate resources for the time being, but everyone should know that we're going to have to deal with this issue in the not too distant future. Within the next 3 to 5 years, we're going to have to make some decisions. The bottom line is we're going to need to either reduce spending or increase revenues, or we maybe could possibly do a little bit of both to bring the spending back in line with the revenues. So for the key for the board and the district is to ensure we're working on a plan to deal with the deficit spending now, to be transparent in terms of how we're handling the situation. And I know that work's already begun. So the plan is the key here in ensuring that that we're being transparent in how we're communicating it to the community.
Thank you. Cal?
Yes. First of all, Anthony Cozy, hands down, is the best financial guy in the state. Very transparent, very open. Anyone can call up and ask him a question. We are in deficit spending. We have been for a number of years. There's a Biden issuance that may come up over the next couple of years, or it may not. Everyone knows we have to cut spending some kind of way, but our biggest expense is teachers. So we can't cut teachers because then class size goes up and no one wants that. You don't want your kid in a class. I don't want my kid in a classroom with 34 other kids. So we are going to find a creative way to not have to have a referendum. We haven't had a referendum in 20 years. We choose to be fair with the taxpayer so we don't max levy if inflation isn't 5%, we don't levy 5%. I mean, people say that we should, and people at the high school say that we should, but we don't think that's fair to charge someone 5%. But at the same time, the profit margin of a school district is only 5%. It's not like GM or Google where we could just make more cars and make more money. So creative solutions will be had over the next couple of years as we move towards our bond issuance.
Thank you. Christine, you're gonna start this next question. How would you approach the teacher shortage?
Wow, that is a great question. Whoever offered that, thank you. I think the teacher shortage is not going to go away soon. And I think we're going to have to go to creative ways of staffing and creative ways of recruiting and retaining teachers. Some of that will relate to incentives. There are a lot of incentives, not only money. And I think some of that will have to happen by our sort of outreach, our marketing, if you will. I know that the district has been great at bringing good teachers to date, but I think we might have to lift our game a little bit to address this teacher shortage.
Thank you. Joe?
Yeah, I agree. It's a tough question. And I think it entails casting a wider net in terms of where we go to find good teachers. You know, perhaps we need to look further out beyond the district, the state, as far as we need to go, finding unique and other ways to ensure that we're reaching potential teaching candidates, and then communicating the benefits of the district and the great community that we live in. I understand that there's a teacher shortage, but I also think that we have the opportunity to showcase the wonderful community that we have, the great district that we have. And I think if we find unique ways of communicating and reaching out to potential candidates, we should be able to be successful at continuing to find great teachers.
Thank you. Cal?
Well, first of all, we started the year with every position was filled as far as teachers go. River Forest is a destination district. They call them destination districts, meaning people come here to lay down roots. They come here, they have children, they build a family, they teach until they retire. Yes, there is a teaching shortage. It's hard to go outside of state because when you come to, if you live in Chicago, you go to Mizzou and you become a teacher and you get licensed there, you have to do more licensing when you get to Illinois. So the rules on that part are very, very difficult. I've been pushing for a teacher intern type of thing at with Concordia, one of our neighbors in town, a great teaching school, because if you're student teaching, the teacher has to relinquish the class to you. So something that we're working on now is teacher internships to get the teaching students interested in teaching at River Forest so that once they become student teachers, we can kind of maybe have them just come and work for us.
Thank you. Eric?
So teaching shortages is something that's gotten a lot of attention in the media, you know, and not recently. I mean, this is something going back 25 years. If we had a half hour, I could give a full lecture about teaching shortages, because it's something that I study. But let me give you the what have I got, about 30 second answer left. Teaching shortages are primarily in the subjects of math, science, special education, and primarily affect disadvantaged districts. As Cal mentioned, River Forest is a destination district. River Forest is not bearing the brunt of the changeover from traditionally certified teachers to alternately certified teachers. I think we're in good shape. We've got all our positions filled. And as long as we maintain being a strong place and a place that teachers want to go, we should be able to fill all our positions, including in math, in science, and in special education.
Thank you. Joe, you're going to start this next question. Can you speak to your thoughts on school ratings, such as ISBE's school report cards, great schools, or niche, where whether standardized test scores matter, and whether our community or those ratings are missing out on data that could be obtained by other or better testing than we're currently doing?
Sure. So school ratings, report cards, standardized test scores, they're very important, but they're certainly not everything. I think we all understand that the ratings and scores are a signal to, you know, those within the community and then beyond about the as to the overall health of the district. So we can't ignore them. We can explore certain strategies to try to improve the scores. One thing that I discussed with one of the administrators recently is that when students take the standardized tests, they take them on the iPad versus how they're tested during the regular school day, which is typically paper and pencil. So we have the opportunity to practice with students with the iPads and have them have some practice sessions taking the exams as they would when they do the official examination. So it's something that's I would describe almost as a necessary evil. We need to benchmark the district. We need to benchmark ourselves relative to what we've done in the past and other areas. We need to understand that they're not perfect measures of student ability and achievement, but we need to do a good job of keeping those scores as high as possible.
Thank you. Cal?
Yes. Standardized testing. It's just too standard. It doesn't say what River Forest students are doing. They're doing a lot better than what the testing says. We look over the report card every year. I've looked over it top and bottom, and you look at these standardized tests that these children take, and you don't know what's in them. You don't know how they're graded or what's coming out of it or anything like that. The one thing that I've said this before, the one thing that I look at on the report card is new. It hasn't been on there for long, but it's something that the school sends, and it's the passing rate of algebra in eighth grade students, which leads on to high school. I think that's very important. And I think we do well in that. We're over 90%. Most better schools are in Naperville and Glencoe are at 55%. So we're way ahead of them in math right now. Am I out of time?
Yes, sorry. You know, I also meant to tell you guys at the beginning that if there's a thought that you want to finish, you can certainly include that in your closing statement also, okay?
Okay.
Eric?
So standardized tests are something that's been well studied in the research literature, and there are basically two major points that emerge from it. Number one is that standardized test scores are related with long-run outcomes. They're related to things like finishing college. They're related to things like later life earnings for kids. The second thing that emerges from the research literature is that standardized tests are not deterministic. So they're not the only thing that matters for those long-run life outcomes. So I think the implications of this is, as a school board, we definitely want to care about achievement for kids, about moving up achievement. That's something that's going to be measured by those standardized tests, but it's not something that we want to be necessarily hyper-vigilant on, because there are other things that matter as well.
Thank you. Christine?
So Cal and I discussed this at breakfast recently, and I've discussed it with the other candidates. And this is a tough thing, because our students have to have some measure by which we can assess progress. They have to have some measure. And while standardized tests have their own idiosyncrasies and issues, the answer can't be that they mean nothing. They do mean something. It's a way for us to track over time longitudinally. And it's also a way for us to tweak and make adjustments where necessary in a decent amount of time. So I'm for standardized testing. I think I don't want teachers teaching to the test. And at the same time, I want them to ensure that these students will do well on those tests. So standardized tests are with us, they're not going anywhere. And I think we have to work with that.
Thank you. Cal, you get the next question. Do you think parents should be able to remove books and change specific curriculum content that they deem inappropriate?
Well, we have to have a definition of what inappropriate is. I think before a parent would want to take a book out or a curriculum out that's inappropriate, I think the school board would probably do it first, or maybe a teacher or an administrator. We're a very small community, and we haven't had any of the problems that are going on in the world as far as inappropriateness for the most part. I think River Forest is a great community because it's small and everyone wants their child to do well. I think that's the important piece of it. And in doing so, we don't do things that are edgy or that are, you know, kind of on the cusp of things. We're just pretty much trying to live our lives and make sure that the children are fine, because our children are going to be leaders. They're going to be leaders of tomorrow. They're not going to be workers for tomorrow. They're going to be leaders. So we're teaching them to lead.
Thank you. Eric?
I think we have great librarians in District 90, and I trust those librarians to make sensible purchases of books that are age appropriate and that open up doors for students to the rest of the world. Now, it's not to say that we can't have a process, but I think we also have to have a very high bar for removing a book from the schools. So I think that's it. I mean, I really would trust our librarians to make good decisions on behalf of our kids.
Thank you. Christine?
Well, I think every kid should read everything they can get their hands on. So I'm for, I'm not for an open banning policy. I agree fully with what Eric said. We have professionals. We have professional teachers. We have professional librarians. And those people spend a lot of time vetting every purchase that is made for books in schools. So I would say overall, I'm comfortable with them making those decisions, and that kids ought to read everything that they can get their hands on.
Thank you. Joe?
I would say I basically agree with most of what's been said. Firstly, that we have great administrators, great librarians, and we can rely on them to make good decisions on behalf of the material that our students have access to. But I don't think this is an issue that's going to come up frequently. However, if it were to arise, I do think that the school board administrators, I do think we should be empathetic to parent concerns. We should listen to parent concerns, weigh them appropriately, and we can work together to make a decision regarding the appropriateness of the material. It's been said many times, we're a small, close-knit community, and I'm sure if we work together, we can come to a resolution that's adequate for everyone.
Thank you. Eric, you're going to get we're coming to the end here. The next question, do you have experience with union negotiations?
So I have not directly negotiated with a union before. In my time working for Illinois Association of School Boards, I did hear a lot and discuss the matter one time with the IASB's chief consultant to school boards on union negotiations. So I learned something there about negotiating with unions. You want to be fair, but you also have to keep in mind that you're the steward of the district's resources, and you have to. That's what you have to do from the position of the school board. You're negotiating. You're on the opposite side of the collective bargaining agreement, and you want to be fair to teachers, but you need to get also the best deal for the community.
Thank you. Christine?
Peggy, I've had the chance to negotiate many contracts, especially during my time as chief operating officer of a consulting firm. As far as union contracts are concerned, my only exposure has been when I was associate dean at the University of Chicago Graduate School of Business. Our administrative staff were all part of a union, and I was our representative to the planning for the negotiations. So that's been my only exposure.
Thank you. Joe?
I would characterize my experience with union negotiations as limited, but I do have experience. So my firm manages a number of Taft-Hartley municipal retirement plans. And as part of that effort, you're constantly negotiating different agreements as it relates to outside vendors and service providers to the plan. So I do have experience in that environment. And I also have experience negotiating, again, with a wide range of vendors across a number of nonprofit, foundation, endowment, board environments. And I think it's something, frankly, that I could bring to the table and something with which I think I could be helpful as it relates to the district and negotiating good agreements on behalf of the district.
Thank you. Cal?
Yes, I have had experience with teacher negotiations. It is quite the experience that if you haven't experienced it, it is a long, long process. And in the end, like Eric said, in the end, there's only 5% that you can raise the levy. So the raises, in my opinion, the raises can't be over 5%. It really can't be over 3% or 3.5%, because you still got to pay the electric bill and the water bill and things like that. So it's really a intense thing, because we love our teachers. They're great people, but at the same time, we can only pay them so much. And we give out benefits on other things, but it's a very intense negotiation. I've done three, and they take upwards of a year of meeting twice a month for 3 hours with them, and then pre-meetings for 2 to 3 hours. So it's a very intense situation.
It is. I know that from experience also. Final question. This is a little bit of a softball for you guys. Elementary school teachers, name one that you remember and why. I could name about 5 or 6, and I'm a lot older than most of you, that still I remember how they impacted my life, making me become a teacher, helping me become a teacher. So name one teacher that you remember from elementary school, K through 8, and why. Christine.
That is a softball, Peggy. And I, like you, could name a dozen people that I worked alongside and people that were my own teachers. I was in Omaha last week, and I went to visit Sister Jackie Ryan, who was my first principal in my first year teaching. And she herself had been a teacher. And I just remember the comfort that I felt when I didn't feel intimidated by this. And it was because of her demeanor. But when she came and sat in my classroom for, dozens of minutes every day for the first month that I was teaching. And I felt so comforted by that, always giving me little tips and little, she'd bring me a book that might add to what I was teaching. And, the people that are in this profession are really something special. And Sister Jackie Ryan is somebody I put way up there.
Thank you. Joe?
Yeah, it's hard to narrow it down to just one, but I guess I have to. So I'd go with my third grade teacher, Mrs. Gilbronson. And I have very fond memories of her. She was a tiny woman, I think I was about as tall as her in third grade, but she just made it so much fun. She made everything fun, and really sort of ignited in me a love of learning that I've carried through to this day. So Mrs. Gilbronson in third grade would be my favorite teacher of all time.
Thank you. Cal?
My favorite teacher was probably my seventh grade teacher, Beverly Ivory. She's 95 years old now, still living. She taught us that we were important. She wanted all of us to be leaders. She wanted all of us to move on and do great things in life. I think I've done a few great things, so I'm happy for that. She disciplined us. That's back in the day when you got paddled. She didn't care about paddling. She called us muckalucks a lot. And it's like the first month she called us muckaluck and we didn't know what it was. She made us look it up. So we went and got this humongous book called the Webster Dictionary. And we looked it up and muckaluck is a snowshoe. she was calling us snowshoes the whole time. So yes, Beverly Ivory, God bless her soul.
Thank you. Eric?
So a lot of great options to choose from. As I mentioned, I attend Willard and Roosevelt. I'm going to focus in on one teacher I had, Mr. Sinise, who was a reading and writing teacher in seventh and eighth grade. So maybe you get to his classroom, if you walk in those Lathrop Street doors and you make a left and go up the staircase, first classroom on the left. And what I remember most about Mr. Sinise is the first writing assignment I turned in, he gave me a C. That was not something I was accustomed to, but it really was, I think a piece of C work. And as he taught and as we learned, I later got my grade up in the course, but he was really, he was fair, but he was tough. And that was one of the reasons why I think I learned at least as much in his classes as I did in anybody else's. And so I thank him for that.
Thank you. All right, we're going to do closing statements now, and we're back to Joe starting off at the closing statements. You get 1 minute for closing statements. Joe, you can start us off.
Sure. Well, thanks again, first to the League of Women Voters and to everyone for attending the forum this evening. As I said in my opening, I firmly believe a high-quality education is one of the most important services a community provides its children. There's been talk about standardized testing and those things during the forum tonight, but I wonder if people may be surprised to learn that according to IllinoisReportCard.com and the Illinois Assessment of Readiness, or IAR, that in our district, 62% of students are meeting English and language arts expectations, and 58% of students are meeting math expectations. We talked about scores aren't perfect, but I do believe they signal we can do better overall. My youngest daughter will graduate from Roosevelt Middle School in 8 years, so I have a vested interest in the district for a long time. And the many conversations I've had leading up to my decision to run for school board, and since then, even up until tonight, the common theme has been everyone agrees our schools are wonderful and filled with caring administrators and teachers. And the other common thread I've heard is that the community doesn't want to rest on its laurels and wants to continue to improve the education we're providing our children. So I'm asking for your vote tonight because I want to help our community, parents, administrators, and teachers work together to ensure we're delivering the absolute best education for our D90 students.
Thank you. Cal?
Yes, a question came up about library books, and everyone was very in tune with saying how librarians would vet that and that'd be fine. I need everyone to realize that our teachers and administrators, they vet the curriculums as well. These things are tested and retested every year. If there's an issue that a parent sees, you better believe a teacher and an administrator have seen it before that. Standardized testing isn't going anywhere. It'll be here forever. But I just want to tell everyone, from a person with a senior in high school, and his and my son's friends are getting into West Point, Cornell, all the Big Ten schools. So the system does work to a degree, because the kids are getting into colleges that they can be successful leaders at in the future. Also, service as a District 90 board member means service to the community. 7 members of District 90 boards. We serve on over 30 outside committees that meet monthly, not only to discuss, but also to establish policy regarding education, social-emotional learning, medical benefits, financing, as well as leadership training to better support our children. I ask for your support tonight, and I thank you.
Thank you, Cal. Eric?
Well, Peggy, thanks again for hosting the forum. Brian, thank you for your help. Thanks to the League of Women Voters. Thanks to all who submitted questions tonight. And thanks to all of you who joined this forum tonight. 3 years ago, we all experienced the start of something that we hope to never experience again in our lifetimes and hope that our children never experience in theirs, which is a global pandemic. Now, things are more or less back to normal. I think for anybody who packed the Roosevelt Middle School auditorium to see Matilda this past weekend, up to the limit of what the fire department will allow, you know that you're feeling that things are back to normal. But I'm not sure for our students that they necessarily are, given the experience of the pandemic that they went through. For those of you who have kids in the schools and are having parent-teacher conferences at the end of this week, ask your teachers whether the third graders are back to where third graders used to be before the pandemic. Ask whether the fifth graders are back to where the fifth graders used to be. Ask whether the seventh graders are back to where the seventh graders used to be. I'm running for school board because I think we need to help the kids catch up from the unfinished learning of the pandemic. We need to consider the lingering effects of the pandemic on their social, emotional, and academic standing. And if elected, I'll always keep an ear open to parents. I will put students first. I will understand that policy is a means to an end to helping our kids and be open to changing it if we see that we need a course correction when we evaluate it. Tonight, I'm asking you for your vote to be given that opportunity to do that and to work on behalf of the River Forest community.
Thank you. Christine?
Yes, I want to say thanks to all the participants. Your presence tonight, signals to the outside world your deep interest and your care for our children in our schools. I want to thank the candidates whose comments I learned from and whose willingness to step forward is really appreciated. And I want to close, I think, with a rally cry. I really believe, like Eric, that now is the time for us to rally around our children, our teachers, and our schools. Our children lost time and thus some advantage through the COVID period. Through no fault of anyone, no one's fault, but it's where we are today. So to maximize their learning recovery, I think we need to maximize our focus on progress. And not that we don't do that every school year, but I think there's an urgency now. And I think we have to really get under the covers, figure out what's working, what's not, and try to bring in as many people as we can to this effort to get our students back to where they belong. All of us have a part in this, and I hope we can work together. I'm asking for your vote to take on that task. Thank you.
Well, thank you, candidates. Public service is the bedrock of democracy, and we thank all the candidates for their time tonight and for choosing to run for local office. Oak Park and River Forest are demanding communities, and you are showing a lot of courage by running for office in either one of these communities. I want to remind everybody that a recording of this event will be posted on our webpage and also on the library's website. Early voting starts on Monday, March 20th, with Election Day, Tuesday, April 4th. More election information is on our website. Please remind your friends, neighbors, and relatives to vote in these elections. Local elections are important. Tax dollars, courses of what happens in your community, local elections are important. So thank you for all your interest tonight and for your attendance, and have a good rest of the evening.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Thank you.